litany of high-up executives in Google who've been engaged in sexual harassment, basically. But in the thing about your man Ruben in particular, it said in a civil suit filed this month by his ex-wife, she claimed he had multiple quote-unquote ownership relationships with other women during their marriage, paying hundreds of thousands of dollars to them. The suit included a screenshot in August 2015 of an email Ruben sent to one of these women, and the quote from him was, you will be happy being taken care of. Being owned is kind of like you are my property and I can loan you to other people. Now, what an absolutely twisted notion. But actually for me, sorry, I'm speaking a bit too loudly. Just so angry. What the people in the back are here. a twisted notion. But actually, if you like, it is a very crude example of how women can be seen in the capitalist system, how everything can be seen as something that you can buy, a commodity, in this case, human beings, and in the context of a sexist society, some, you know, asshole, to be honest, CEO, thinks that he can do that with women. And it's just really interesting to me to see this action of Google workers. I think it was up to 17,000 or more even taking action around the world, including hundreds and hundreds, maybe even 1,000 in Dublin on Thursday. And just this is a quote from one of the women, I think in, they're usually in San Francisco, these places, their headquarters, it's probably San Francisco, somewhere in the States anyway. One of the women workers who organised this this action. So she said, all employees and contract workers across the company deserve to be safe. Sadly, the executive team has demonstrated through their lack of meaningful action that our safety is not a priority. We waited for leadership to fix these problems, but have come to this conclusion, no one is going to do it for us. So we are here, standing together, protecting and supporting each other. We demand an end to sexual harassment, discrimination, and systemic racism that fuel this destructive culture. And it's just to say they formulated a whole set of demands around how sexual harassment is dealt with, but also around questions of pay equality as well. And let's, like the nature of Google, we know obviously it will be a better off section of working class people or whatever that work in that company, but absolutely many workers. But one of the things is that the whole company has fostered this idea that, like, there's no class division in Google, that it's, you know, one whole, not a company, a community or something like this. And just to see, like, by the way, we know the reality of Google, an enemy to humanity that dodges tax, and in Ireland it receives corporate welfare because it doesn't have to pay very much tax. So, for example, in Ireland 2 years ago, it had 22 billion euro in sales revenue, but only paid 47 million in tax, which is like a joke. But to see like this idea breaking on the question of sexual harassment, but also then linked into pay equality and numerous questions, and then Google workers, obviously of all genders, taking this action, it's really significant development to me. And then we've seen, it's been mentioned numerous times today, the really inspiring strikes of McDonald's workers, also in the US, that being inspired by me too, but I've taken it into the workplace and made it, these are the same workers also fighting for $15 an hour and so on. You know, just that any action of this character has been taken in the workplace is very significant. Obviously that's one site in which sexual harassment and assault happens. There's many other sites, both on the street, in the homes. Six violent deaths, horrifically, have happened on this island, we think as a result of macho violence so far this year. And a movement on these questions is very much needed, and a movement in the workplace on these questions will have an impact on workers, but also will have an impact in challenging macho culture more generally in society, which is absolutely necessary. It's also really important that we pay tribute to and send solidarity to the workers in Glasgow who last week took very historic action, actually, 8,000 workers on strike, for equal pay, essentially. This is like a pay claim their union has been like pursuing kind of through arbitration and so on for years and years and years, but the workers have taken action and are saying, we're not waiting any longer, we want the pay and the back pay that we require. And it was very inspiring to see bin workers who obviously will be more male. It's not in many countries in Europe, you see bin workers, and not many for some reason around this part of the world they are. It's very gendered workforces that we tend to have. Mainly male workforces that workforce that took solidarity action, like refused to cross the picket line. Like huge parts of Glasgow City or aspects of Glasgow City were shut down that day, showing the power of such an action actually. And to me it also draws attention to the type of work that women tend to do in capitalist society and neoliberal capitalist society in particular, because it was the likes of like home care workers, nursery teachers, cleaners, by the way, all workers that do an invaluable, play an invaluable role in society, who generally are very low paid, you know? And there's other aspects to that as well. So it's linked to a broader question of why there's this inequality, gender inequality under the capitalist system. And one of the, a very strong aspect of it is, if you like, capitalism needs a workforce, the only way that it can make its profits every day. And it relies on a huge amount of unpaid labour for that workforce to be replenished all the time. And the unpaid work that majority women do is a big part of that. You know, it's a huge part of the capitalist economy globally, in fact. And it's of necessity. And because of the ideology that goes along with that, that it's women's role, not quote-unquote, naturally to be the carers and nurturers and blah, blah, blah. It also feeds into the fact that when you actually do paid work in this arena, you're much more likely to be low paid, because it's just not valued actually. And then you have a whole other aspect on top of that, which is the neoliberal drive in capitalism for many decades. And part of that is a very extreme privatization drive. So the likes of home care on this island has been a public service for a whole period, but it's more and more being privatized, which results in two aspects that are very negative. One, obviously, for the workers themselves, because in a privatized working environment, it's generally just more difficult. Those who work in privatized home care, like Joe Duffy, of all people, actually did a good thing on it. They were ringing up, and it's like, you only get paid for the time that you're in the house. You're traveling a huge amount between workplaces and you don't get paid a penny for it. It's an absolute joke. But the other side of it then is, if you privatize these services, the people who can access them, like there's asked a question of class involved there as well, because it makes it less accessible to working class people, and then the burden of care that's unpaid gets more intense in terms of working class women, which we know is a huge aspect of society in Ireland, given the lack of ever been a strong welfare state and so on that has existed like Britain, but has been attacked hugely under neoliberal capitalism. Around globally, we have discussed a little bit today the huge polarization that exists. There's a very dangerous and threatening rise of the right in many states around the world, the populist right, the far right. It is a very significant, obviously, setback and very dangerous and threatening that Bolsonaro has been elected in Brazil, a country of over 200 million, and that will have a huge impact on the whole of Latin America, what happens in that state, but also just what that means for women, LGBT people, poor working class people, and the left in Brazil. You know, it's a very serious situation. This is somebody who says he supported the dictatorship. In fact, that the left-wing activists under the dictatorship that were tortured should have been killed. Quite extreme, anti-democratic, linked to fascist organisation and so on. Very, very serious. However, how has this occurred? The PT have to be put in the dock in the sense of, while wrapping themselves in the red flag and supposed to be standing for socialism, they really stayed very much in the confines of capitalism and even of neoliberalism, but did, in the context of a boom and a commodities boom, were able to bring in some reforms that did lift some working class and poor people out of extreme poverty, which was significant. But you couldn't maintain that. You can't balance between keeping the elite in the position of elite, not touch them, multinational corporations, and also be in the interest of working and poor people. It's a complete contradiction. And then the huge crisis and crash that they've essentially, you know, presided over, of course then the blame goes on them, the blame goes on so-called left and socialists, but the problem is that they didn't implement those politics. The thing with Bolsonaro is his economic program is really hard neoliberal right, and that will be resisted. That will be resisted en masse in Brazil, and it has to result in the building of a socialist left challenge that does not take the approach that the PT has taken. But we will maybe send a message of solidarity to all our siblings in Brazil fighting against Bolsonaro and what he represents at this time. I think that's very, very important that we do that today. I think, just to say, obviously, we put in the context also Trump. It's also like what Peter Casey tried to do in the presidential elections. Quite rotten. You know, pretending you're against the establishment but actually standing for an even harder type of neoliberal capitalism. I don't really know if Peter Casey knows this shit in that regard, except maybe his own profits, but some of them do, Bolsonaro does. Picking on a vulnerable section of the population and trying to turn people against it instead of, in order to cut across actually the building of a united movement of working class and oppressed people. I think for me, that example of your man Andy Rubin and his, you know, vile carry-on, the CEO, former executive in Google that got that big payoff, it's a bit of a metaphor for the system, actually, the rottenness of the system. And Google as a company, you know, what it tries to, the absolute hypocrisy of it, it tries to be so, you know, will wrap itself in the rainbow flag, I'm sure not when they're operating in Russia or whatever, and they, you know, they will try and be also trendy and inclusive, etc. in their language, but not in their reality. And they don't pay, you know, they dodge tax, they engage in all this. And that has concrete effect. Like, how do you think health services are paid for? Do you know what I mean? Like, this is real. It's a really rotten thing, by the way. You know, it's not acceptable in any way, shape, or form. But then there's many other companies in capitalism that don't even try to do that. They're more naked. But the truth, you know, in terms of their rottenness. But the Walmart, one that mentioned earlier today or whatever, and some of the maybe businesses that Amy was referring to in her speech. But the point is, they're all part of the one system that presides over the reality that nearly 1 billion human beings globally live in slums. Many of whom are workers, by the way. They're going to work every day and they're going home and existing in slums. The drive for profit's destruction of the environment, that is just something that every person has to really consider. What am I doing? And it's not, you know, changing your personal ways of living makes absolutely not by all means, it's a morally, you know, good thing to do. Not blame anyone who would take that approach individually, but it is not going to make a dent in the ruthless drive for profits destruction of the environment that has to be challenged in a collective way on a systemic basis. And then the truth of it is, it's about the overall wealth inequality drive at the heart of capitalism. The private ownership of wealth, what that means socially. Look at the housing crisis. The housing crisis in Ireland, the root cause of it is an approach that's just links housing to the market and to profit. And this horrific crisis has been caused as a result with, you know, untold human suffering happening in hotels, in rented accommodation, in housing estates, all around us, right as we speak. Probably many people in this room suffering from it in different ways as well. That is not acceptable. Look at the direct provision case was highlighted on social media this week. A mother with an extremely sick child in direct provision, who asked because the child was puking violently, tried to get an extra slice of bread, and was denied it by the way, private company that presides over and profits from direct provision. This is the type we have to build a movement that can challenge that. The repeal victory shows what struggle what solidarity, what optimism can achieve, because within that we had to put pro-choice demand center stage. We couldn't be like, oh please give us a bit of our rights, you would have got nothing. We had to demand, make strong, you know, demand what we actually needed in order to win. And we won extremely important rights. The right to bodily autonomy for our individuals is an extremely important right. But it also has other aspects to it. Like, you think about it, since 1980, 150,000 people have travelled abroad to access abortion. That can cost up to 800 to 1,000 euro. Now, where's that money going? It's going to Ryanair. It's going to, some dodgy, cheap hotel in the city of Manchester. That money is now going to be in the hands of working class people that otherwise would have to spend it, because we've won this victory and because we won it as 12 weeks on request. And it's going to be provided for free. Obviously not with perfect, as Ruth explained, or anything like that, but that is a huge victory, and we should register how big it is. And with that, if you like, it's part of a struggle as to who controls the wealth in society. That's the type of struggle we need to wage. We have to stand against any attempts of division. You know, so in terms of the housing movement, it has to be about homes and housing for all. It's not, from the traveller community to migrants, to refugees, to, you know, the mass of working class people, you know, all of them in some way, through a family member or whatever, are touched by this crisis. We have to challenge the wealth that's in the hands of the tiny minority so we can have enough quality housing for everyone. We refuse to be divided because there is not enough wealth for everybody to have a good life, on a global level actually. That's the type of movement that we need. Just going to kind of finish up in a minute, maybe just say like two or three things before I do that. But the two or three things are this, that as part of organising today, obviously we're a grassroots movement. We need money to put up our posters and so on. So we do appeal that you will consider making a donation to ROSA today to aid us with our work, to keep on campaigning on all these issues and building a socialist feminist force that we ask you to obviously part of doing as well. But donating can help us to do that. You can give small amounts of money. If you like, you could buy one of our jumpers in solidarity. It's 15 euro, they're lovely, very warm hoodies, 15 euro or 20 euro solidarity price. So we'd encourage you to do that. So yeah, this, I'm going to finish up with a quote from James Connolly. Probably most of you know who he is, but some visitors from abroad might not. He was an absolutely incredible socialist revolutionary in Irish history. He died very famously very tragically in 1916, but was a powerful voice for workers and the oppressed on a global level. And the reason why I love this quote is it makes the point. He is a cop on. It's the opposite of some of the Jordan Peterson ideas that some people unfortunately brought to meet today, as a charlatan, divisive figure that's trying to target a marginalised group or pose as anti-establishment, by the way. An oppressed group, they have the right to say what their issues are. Like the traveller community, if they want to be recognised as an ethnic group, we have to support that. Do you know, if they want to be able to live their life in a way that is different to what a settled person would do, we support that. You know, and they should be facilitated to do that. So any oppressed group, they should actually be listened to. And in fact, they have to wage their own struggle to emancipate themselves in that way. But also that the only way we'll challenge the whole system that actually is fueled by exploitation and oppression is if we build a united movement of all the working class and oppressed together. So he says, none so fitted to break the chains as those that wear them, none so well equipped to decide what is a better, but whosoever carries the outwork of the citadel of oppression, the working class alone can raise it to the ground. So I think that's pretty apt and brilliant message for today. We want to finish by saying, as Ruth mentioned that we opened the session with, International Women's Day, 8th of March 2019, we will not go backwards in Ireland. The last couple of International Women's Day, we brought the history and the roots and the real meaning of International Women's Day onto the streets through struggle, and we have to continue that. There is a call for a global women's strike, and there has to be action in Ireland on that basis. International Women's Day is Friday, 8th of March, Friday, 8th of March 2019, and the idea that there won't be protests with broad demands in all the cities, I think we should put the call out as ROSA and ask other groups to sign up to, ask trade unions and so on to sign up to, and you could have quite a broad set of demands linked to questions of the day, sexual harassment in the workplace, violence against women and gender non-conforming people, the right to abortion for everybody around the world and standing in solidarity with those struggling for that right, etc, etc. We could draw up a list of broad demands. I think it would be really, really important that we put that call out today. And actually, we'd like maybe just to begin that discussion by getting people to vote on that idea today, if they would support the idea of protests as part of the global feminist movement and the women's strike on the 8th of March of next year. So we might ask people to do that before we finish up and Laura closes the meeting. Is that okay? So, well, in peace, baby clap and then do that. So would you take a photo? Ruth, will you take a photo? Yeah. So can we get, do people want, are people up for making a show of hands for the idea of a day on the International Women's Day in Ireland that we join the global movement and have protests, probably lunchtime in cities, there might be some walk-ins and so on as part of that. Is that something we can kind of endorse at the meeting today? Very good. Katya's doing hands up at
the back. There's a few people abstaining.
Oh dear. Thanks everyone.